You are listening to a free version of the Majority Report with Sam Steeter. To support this show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeter.
It is Wednesday, June 20th, 2018. My name is Sam Steeter. This is the five-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today, Rolling Stone reporter, author Matt Taibbi, on his three-part series, Battle of Woodstock. What will win Congress for the Democrats? Meanwhile, the Trump White House and their Republican enablers are literally stealing babies. Literally stealing babies from their parents. Meanwhile, fake nonprofits profiting over these children detentions. Protests, fundraisers gear up across the country to fight this creeping, maybe galloping, fascism. And the U.S. withdraws from the U.N. Human Rights Council because, of course, Commerce Secretary Wilbur Ross short sells with inside knowledge. Michael Cohen wants payback from Trump. Wants his legal fees covered. Paul Manafort is in solitary now for his own protection. Canada votes to legalize pot. Will we ever hear from Jimmy Reefercake again? And Turning Point USA hit with allegations of sexual assault. Yes, happy Wednesday, ladies and gentlemen. All this and more on today's program. I imagine most of you have heard the latest that there are these tender age now detention centers. You just imagine the thought process that goes into naming these, like the level of awareness that one must have when one comes up with this name, the tender age detention centers. And just a couple of quick stories. A Honduran woman named Ana Rivera has not seen her five-year-old son, Jairo, in over a month. That's according to the New Yorker's Jonathan Blitzer. The Detroit Free Press today is reporting that an 11-month-year-old and an 8-month-year-old showed up in a detention center in Michigan, and they were taken from their kids, their parents, weeks ago. An 11-month-old and an 8-month-old baby. And then, to top it off, a 10-year-old with Down syndrome was taken from her mother after they were involved in a illegal border crossing, even though her father is and the girl was sent to a Texas shelter, even though her father is a legal U.S. resident who lived just an hour away. And the response to this story, apparently was on Fox News. Is that the only one that allows Corey Lewandowski to still go on? So Corey Lewandowski, the former Trump campaign chief and current probably daily advisor, was on Fox News to debate the Trump administration's policy of stealing children from their parents. And with the Democratic strategist, I guess the guy's name was Zach Pencanus. Listen to this exchange and Corey Lewandowski's response when Petkanis raises this issue of a 10-year-old with Down syndrome.
I mean, look, I read today about a 10-year-old girl with Down syndrome who was taken from her mother and put in a cage. Read about did you say want to a 10-year-old with Down syndrome
what
being
I
taken
said
from
is
her
you
mother?
Can pick anything
how
you
dare
want
you?
Up, but the bottom line
how
is very
dare
clear.
You?
When you cross
how absolutely
the border
dare you,
illegally,
sir?
You
how
have
dare
given
you?
Up the...
I mean, I got to hand it to that guy for not just saying fuck you and then honestly.
What else is there to say?
Unbelievable.
He's scum. He's subhuman.
They're sadistic. They're sadists, and it's grotesque. It's grotesque. So that's what's the state of play. We'll talk more in the program after we talk to Taibbi about. Let me just actually get this out here. Now, there's a couple of things that you should be aware of. Obviously, by now, hopefully, you are aware of the protests that are happening on the 30th around. You can go and sign up for those protests. You can either sign up, find out where they're being located. You can start your own. We'll put the link in today's show notes. I don't have it right here. It's I don't have the actual. I thought I had it here, but I don't have it. We'll put it in the link. It was in yesterday's thing. Could someone take a look at it? What was written in yesterday's post and let me know what it is. Also, we're going to put in a link to a list of stuff that can be done in support of families that Alexis Goldstein put together, and we'll put that in the show post today too. What was the
Does it make the wave 2018?
No. It was the families thing that we put in
that
yesterday.
Wasn't, I don't see it.
Oh, it didn't. So it didn't get in yesterday's post. All right. We'll work on it today right and we'll deal with it. But I don't know. We talked about it yesterday. It should have been in the post. Familiesbelongtogether.org. Familiesbelongtogether.org. Let's make sure we put it in today's post. We had talked about it yesterday. Meanwhile, the New Yorker was responsible for reporting at least on one of those stories about the woman who I think is suing now the Trump administration for the Honduran woman who has not seen her 5-year-old son in over a month. I believe she's suing. And according to Jonathan Blitzer in the New Yorker, during the first 12 days that she spent in federal custody, Rivera, the woman, had no idea where her son was. She stopped eating. She could barely sleep. She cried constantly. The stress was too much. No one could give her any information about her child. She didn't have a lawyer to help her press the point. By the time she arrived at an ICE facility on May 18th, she'd become so upset she had trouble speaking. The New Yorker, as you know, is an iconic magazine that has continually provided some of the best writing and reporting in America today. If you head over to the New Yorker right now, you can see a lot of different stories. This one by Blitzer is part of the Dispatch. There is a story from an attorney on what it's like to represent children taken from their parents. Commentary, culture writing. Of course, you have all the critics, the review of books, arts, TV, and more. But in times like this, really crucial reporting and reporting that you can trust, they take their work very seriously. And one of the benefits of subscribing to The New Yorker, you can access their complete archive. featuring digital replicas of every issue in the print magazine from 1925 with your subscription. Don't wait. Go to www.newyorker.com/majority. Receive 12 issues for $12 plus a free tote bag. If you enter my code majority, you will unlock 50% off of your subscription. So that's 12 issues for $6 and a free tote bag. You can get it delivered to your mailbox, inbox, or both by choosing between print, digital, or a combination. Subscribe to The New Yorker. Read something that means something. That's $12 for $6 and a free tote bag when you go to newyorker.com/majority and then enter my code majority at checkout. That's a great deal and important to keep yourself informed and with, you know, reporting that you can really trust. They're very rigorous.
And a recently unionized newsroom.
And they just unionized, too. And tomorrow's guest is also from The New Yorker. I mean, so, you know, this is one of those ads where I'm happy to read because it's a product, obviously, not only that I use, but we use for content on this program. So, meanwhile, there are protests happening at Microsoft, where the employees are having a problem with their work with ICE. Like I said, there are protests going around the country. And this happened last night. For some ungodly reason, Kirstjen Nielsen, who is the head of the Department of Homeland Security, who has been claiming they have no policy of separating parents from their children or children from their parents. She got in her mind last night. She was hungry, apparently, and decided, I know, I'll go to a Mexican restaurant to eat. I mean.
The merity of these people.
There's one of two answers to this question. Why would someone do that? One is that she wanted to prove that she had nothing against Mexican people and was willing to go to a restaurant. Or three options. Two, she's just so completely oblivious to what is going on that it doesn't even occur to her that there may be some folks at a Mexican restaurant who, never mind any restaurant, who would take issue with her inhumane execution of a policy. Or three, they just think that this is good for them. But this is the response that she got. 10 to 15 protesters entered MXDC Cochina Mexicana around 8 p.m. while Nielsen was finishing a meal with another person. DSA members showed up, I guess. And this is what she was greeted with. Members are walking into the restaurant now.
Okay, I'm going to go around the corner.
Shame! 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 Shame!
There you go. And then this is a shot of her walking out of the restaurant after she was her meal was so rudely interrupted. I hope there is literally no place in public where she can go and eat. Here we go. Needing a police escort to take her away. That's great. She should have to be constantly under guard, feeling like she is in her own detention cell, as far as I'm concerned.
We just have a note for the live viewers. It's cutting out for the when we go to the video screen, but it will be clipped just fine.
Okay. All right. We got to take a quick break. When we come back, Matt Taibbi.
When the youth of today, in the early 7 seconds, taught me some of life's most valuable lessons. There's gonna come a time when the scene will seem less sunny. It'll probably get druggy and the kids will seem too skinny. There's gonna come a time when she's gonna have to go with whoever's gonna get her the highest. There's gonna come a time when the true scene leaders get where they differ and get big picture, cause the kids at the shows, they'll have kids of their own. They'll sing along songs and be our scriptures.
We are back. Sam Cedar on the Majority Report on the phone. It is a pleasure to welcome back to the program. Rolling Stone reporter, are you like an editor? What?
A correspondent, I guess.
Correspondent?
I don't know. Reporter?
Honest.
Yeah.
The
yeah.
author of multiple books. His latest is a 3-part series, The Battle of Woodstock. Matt Taibbi, welcome back to the program.
Good to talk to you, Sam.
So now you've been up in New York's 19th district. And just so that folks don't think this is too sort of like narrowly focused, and I have to say, like, this is a district that I have voted in for the past, I don't know, about 15 years or so. I used to live up there full time, and used to be the 20th district. Why are you looking at this district as, and what is it? What are we hoping to glean in a sort of a more macro sense, I guess?
I just thought the district was very representative of a lot of things that are going on in the Democratic Party, a lot of challenges that the party is facing, and a lot of trends that are going on in sort of intramural fashion that maybe are contributing to the threat of some underwhelming results in November. One of the things that's interesting about this race is that it has this huge number of candidates in the primary. There's seven candidates, and several of them kind of represent, as one voter put it to me, like each of the major financial factions of the Democratic Party is represented. Right. There's a Wall Street bankruptcy attorney. There's a defense contractor. There's a manufacturer who's moved jobs overseas. There is a person who was a political aide to Andrew Cuomo. So it's kind of got all the food groups of the Democratic Party represented in this one little crucible.
Now, people should know about this district. At one time, it was John Sweeney, I think was his name. He got booted out when it was the 20th district because he was, I think it was in 06 when he got caught up in the whole Republican scandal and corruption sweep. There were pictures of him partying with college kids. I think he was holding the joint at the time. I don't have a problem with him smoking a pot, but I mean, you shouldn't necessarily, as a congressman, be partying with college kids. And
probably not. Yeah,
there was some other issues. I think he had domestic issues, if I remember correctly. Kirstjen Gillibrand won this district. She grew up here, and this was the district she came out of when she was appointed as senator. Then I think it was Brian Murphy, if memory serves me correctly, who was a millionaire Democrat, self-financed. He came in, he won. He was ousted by another guy who was from Kinderhook. I can't remember his name now, but he was like a six-term, like a three-tour Iraq vet, a guy in his, I think, 50s, had been in that that district his whole life, and now John Faso beat Zephyr Teachout 2 years ago. So this is one that is also a real, like, legitimate purple district. You've got about 6,000 yeah. more Republicans. So there's a lot of different factors that goes into play. Tell us about the dynamic between the seven candidates.
Well, I think if you ask the candidates themselves how they would characterize the field, or actually it's probably more if you ask the activists in the community, they would tell you that there are basically two candidates who kind of fit the Bernie wing pretty snugly. One is Jeff Beals, who's an ex CIA analyst and diplomat, believe it or not, who has won the, he's now a history teacher in Woodstock, and has won the endorsement of a bunch of Bernie groups. And then there's a local trial attorney named Dave Clegg, who's been there for 37 years. He's the only person in this race who's voted in the district more than once. And then there's a whole bunch of candidates who are kind of more leaning towards the Democratic mainstream. There's a lot of money that's come into this race, somewhere upwards of $6 or $7 million now, just for the primary. And that's Antonio Delgado from Akin Gump. There's Brian Flynn, who is an ex-Citibank executive. And some others. So it's really, there's five candidates who people sort of characterize as mainstream Democrats, and two who are characterized typically as kind of the progressives.
What's also interesting about this race is, and knowing this district and seeing the history, is that you got Beals and Clegg, who are the more Bernie, the more simpatico with the Bernie wing. Although you write about how, you know, Brian Flynn, who is, I think, that former Citibank guy and manufacturing guy, has sort of like adopted at least some of the rhetoric of sort of the Bernie wing, if you will, while at the time raising over $1 million. That's what sets apart some of these people. Also, geographically, Beals and Clegg come from Ulster County, which is a lot less moneyed county than on the western side of, or I should say on the eastern side of the river. And that has a big, that seems to me also to be a big dynamic. One is sort of considered more local, I guess, and one is more transient. When you're talking about like Dutchess County, which is almost like a communer, close to a communer county with New York City. And so let's talk about how the DCCC has been involving themselves in this race, because this has been sort of one of the big narratives of this election cycle is, I guess, people's understanding of the DCCC and to some extent the DNC getting involved in these races, you know, representing the establishment. And talk about that dynamic.
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the things that's going on all over the country. There are a lot of races where the DCCC is openly sticking a finger on the scale and coming in and giving an endorsement of one form or another to one of the candidates. A classic example is a district upstate in New York. I forget the number of the district. It's the one where that includes Syracuse. But the candidate who was running more or less unopposed for a while, Dana Balter, is sort of a progressive. And the D-Trip figured she wasn't raising enough money, and they gave their red-to-blue endorsement to a woman named Juanita Perez-Williams, who came in very late to the race. And this kind of thing is going on a lot all around the country. There was a race in Colorado where Steny Hoyer basically told some progressive to jump out of the race because the decision had already been made to throw their money behind somebody else. And in this race, I've talked personally to a bunch of the candidates involved, and particularly Beals and Clegg tell me that the D-Trip, once they figured out that these guys didn't have any corporate money behind them, they just didn't return their calls, didn't talk to them again. And, they claim not to be overtly supporting any of the candidates in the race, but it really comes down to a question of money. Clegg has told me that he's had people who want to give his campaign money, but they say we have to check with the DCCC first, and then they never call him back. So this divide between the National Party and this kind of new wave of Our Revolution, Justice Democrats candidates, it's a real thing, and it's present in this race and present in a lot of races around in New York and around the country.
So now, how much of this is and how much of this? I mean, because you talk about the resources and the inability of these sort of national campaign apparatus to actually like to be able to do their job. I mean, you know, to a certain extent, there's a quality to this that sounds like it's partially ideology, but it also seems like it's a function of we have no other way in which to really make any type of assessment. So we're going to just do the one that is, you know, a number. Like,
right.
It's like a college that has no admissions department. We have no ability to interview anybody. So we're just going to pick like a number. And you got to get this on your test. And this is the only way for them to, in some way, seem to stay relevant. So they're not doing their job. They're just, which is presumably right, to get Democrats elected. But they can't do their job properly. So they just do their job and make it seem like they're making an assessment when they're really not.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. And they're basing their criteria on these incredibly arbitrary distinctions. I mean, Beals told me an incredible story where he was about to have his introductory sort of meeting phone call with somebody from the National Party. And just before the call, he gets a call from like a local backer of the Democratic Party who says, "Oh, I hear you're about to have this call. Let me tell you what you're going to say." He said, they're going to ask you two questions. They're going to say, how much can you raise in the first 3 months? And how much do you think you need to win the race? And here's your answer. You tell them $300,000 to the first question, and then you tell them $1.5 million to the second question. And then, you know, that's 10 minutes before the call, he hangs up, the D-trip calls, they ask him exactly those questions. How much can you raise in the first 3 months? How much do you need to win the election? And he gives them the right answers, but they clearly don't believe him. And he misses his fundraising target, which he calls paying the VIG. And, you know, he's basically not in the picture anymore as far as the National Party goes. So that's really how they operate. What they're looking for is somebody who can raise a certain amount of money, because a lot of what this is about is an old formula based on how much money we need to get the ad saturation over a certain period of time. And if you can't get that money and if you can't buy those ads, you're not a serious candidate to us. So they're not paying attention to anything else. They're just paying attention to the number.
And is there, I mean, is there any, when you approach the DCCC and say, you know, how about this? Do they come back to you and say, well, look, here's the data, right? Like this district has never been won by a candidate with this type of money disparity, or a district with these demographics and this spread out. I mean, do they have any data to support like the idea that money is important, as opposed to looking at that district and saying, like, there needs to be somebody from the west side of the river because, you know, the east side is reliably voting, but the west side doesn't, or that, you know, this person has these relationships with the community and this is super important. Like, do they have any data to support the sort of, I guess, the unstated conclusion that you need to have, you know, $1.4 million?
No, they don't come back at you with data. What they come back at you with is, we are not interfering. We are just making helpful recommendations as to what we think will help make successful candidates. But there's no, so they don't argue that any of this is based upon a close study of that particular district or even about national trends. All it is really just an ingrained belief that you need to raise a lot of money because the way you win elections is to buy ads. And some other candidates have told me, you know, they had like a training seminar in Washington where they bring the people down and they basically sit all of the potential candidates in a room, and they have big shot Democrats like Nancy Pelosi and come in and offer advice. And what they say to all of them is, your best, the time you spend, it's best spent being in a room, getting used to the idea of spending 8, 9, 10 hours a day dialing for dollars, reserving as much call time as you can. I'm sure you know what that term means. It just right. means, you know, yeah. So plan on doing that as much as possible, raise as much money as possible, and try to find ways to make it fun. And that's how you're going to win elections. And they even expressly said to people like Clegg tells me that, you know, he actually said, is that the best way to do this? I mean, I have a lot of local connections. I could be spending my time doing other things. And they're like, you can't run this like a local election. It's based on the idea that these territories are too big to get any other way except by mass media. And the only way to get mass media is through money.
I mean, I can tell you that there is an enormous amount of mailers that they're sending out.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, just an enormous mm-hmm. amount of mailers. But, you know, the reality is that I don't think that there is like media up there that would blanket it anyways. like, you know, you're talking about six, you know, in this particular instance. And I guess, you know, the point is with this is just that it is the recommendations. And it may very well be that a guy like Pat Ryan, like who's a defense contractor, right, who's raised $1.3 million, mm-hmm. or Brian Flynn or maybe Delgado, these people who have raised the big money, they may actually be more suited for the district. But it doesn't even seem like that assessment is being made on who they are. I mean, you know, they're, you know, like the for that particular district, it's super gun happy. And if there is some notion that that you are, you know, anti-gun in any way, you have a problem. But that doesn't, you know, none of these things seem to even come into play, which is the scary part, right? Like it's not just that they're just looking at money. It's that, you know, there are several moneyed candidates in there. How do you distinguish as to which one is really actually more suited for this district?
Yeah, no, I mean, this is the point that I've been trying to get at throughout this entire time. And everybody thinks that I'm hammering Democrats just for the sake of doing it. And that's not what it is. I just think that they have a faulty formula for how they go about not only picking candidates, but identifying what their issues are with voters and listening to voters. I mean, the strategy that they've settled on conveniently exculpates them from having to go out, do a lot of pressing the flesh, listening to people, hearing what the complaints are, responding in an idiosyncratic manner, policy-wise, to what the needs of the district are. I mean, I think there are some candidates in this race that have tried to do that. I mean, Gareth Rhodes, who is the former Cuomo aide, he did ride all around the district. He visited every single village in the district, and he came away with some interesting small ideas. But there's no micro assessment going on of who is more suited for what district, what message might be better for what district, what your policy package needs to be. It's just not about that. It just keeps coming back to the money, and that's, it's not just coming from one source on this. This is literally everybody that I've talked to in this race, except for maybe one or two candidates, and they're all telling me the same thing. And I think this in a roundabout way gets to what happened in 2016, where you saw a lot of the same dynamic, which was we just need to raise a ton of money, and there's just less and less emphasis on appearing in person, which can be a more effective way of, you know, getting intelligence and spreading the message.
And it seems to me the problem too is that it's actually worse than doing nothing, because you're interfering with the potential of something organic happening within the district, right? Because you are directing outside resources to not flow to one place or another. I mean, if Clegg is to be believed, this is one of the trial attorney in Ulster. People are coming to him. They're about to give him money, but they're just saying, I just need, sign off from the National Democrats. And they say, no, don't do it. People are disinclined from making, you know, people who are closer to the ground, as it were, whose impulses have arguably, you know, just as much validity, if not more, right? Because they're close to the ground. They have some type of organic sense of what's going on in this district. If their inclination is to give money and then it's stopped from the outside, it's almost worse than the law of averages.
Yeah, no, that's exactly right. And one of the things that the emphasis on money will do for you is that in a primary race, it can have a clear deciding effect, because not many of these candidates have name recognition across this district, which is enormous, by the way. It's like the size of New Jersey or something like that. It would be very hard for any one person, even working and living in the district for 40 years to have business in each of the nooks and crannies of this place. So the media and buying, doing ad buys and mailers can get your name in the paper enough, can get your name in front of enough eyeballs so that you'll win a primary. But when it comes to a general race against a Republican who's got just as much money or more, you may be left with a candidate who just isn't quite as suited idiosyncratically
right.
to that region. And so you're exactly right. They might have been better off just not running or not funneling the money into the district, because what you might be left with, if you didn't do that, is some homegrown candidate who has more credibility, who can't be branded a carpetbagger. You have to think about what's going to be said in the general about a lot of these candidates. And they just might not be part of the picture if the money wasn't there.
Yeah, and we should say, this district is sort of like a perfect test case for that, because Zephyr Teachout moved up there to run in this district. This has been an ongoing the round before that, it was the Facebook guy who had come in there and had moved up there for, a couple of months. And the idea that, six out or five out of seven of these people running have never been eligible to run to vote in an election up there is sort of nuts, right?
I know.
It's nuts to me. This is clearly a district that can be won by the right Democrat, and it's a tightrope, because all you got to do is look at what Kirstjen Gillibrand, where she moved, physically but also politically, when she was congressperson there, her stance on immigrants getting licenses, I think, was slightly different. Driver's licenses, you look on what was going on in terms of guns. Now, this was a decade ago, and it was a different time. But even still, there's a certain amount of nuance. You have to be aware of the district to win
yeah.
it. Is there and so there's, to the extent that there's any ideology involved in this, it's only, it seems to me, to be a function of A, the people at the DCCC who think money is, money, it's just a number, right? If there was some other way to hand out a number, they'd probably go with that. If there was, it's almost reminiscent of education reform, right? Where it's just like, we just need a number, and that's the way we're going to measure it. And even if that number isn't necessarily accurate, it gives us something to compare apples to apples. But the problem
right.
is that the people who raise the money, if they have the ability to raise that kind of money on their own without sort of the national support or national attention, it's indicative of who they spend their time with. And
or what they do for a living. Exactly.
And so the ideology, it's not that they're making an ideological decision. It's just that they're using a filter that is necessarily going to, more often than not, bring about a specific ideological result.
Well, right. This is a district which is mostly white. Almost entirely white. It's not doing catastrophically badly economically, but there's a lot of struggling people in this
yeah.
district. In particular, there are some industries that have been hit pretty hard. There were the, sort of hotel resort areas that don't really exist anymore. The dairy farmers have been crushed in this region. So there's a lot of people who are just kind of barely hanging on. And if you do a lot of door knocking on the campaign, you'll find that the only people whose houses are in good upkeep, they tend to be either prison workers or teachers or somebody who has a paycheck and benefits from some kind of state job. And so if that's your reality, if that's who the voters are, you know, it's pretty tough to say, well, we're going to bring in a millionaire bankruptcy attorney or, another businessman. The NRCC is killing Flynn this week because he has a mailer that shows him talking about how billionaires are rigging the system, and he's wearing a $9,000 Rolex in the picture. Mm. It's stuff like that. It just makes it hard. You know, I understand that you need money to run, and it doesn't mean these people are bad people or even that their politics are bad. It's just a question of, like, who's going to identify with this kind of candidate. And, you know, the money is a separator. It just is. I mean, and so if you're using that as your standard, it can have a deleterious effect on the whole thing.
So, all right. So here is the question I have for you. What, you know, like, from my perspective, right, I want to vote strategically. I don't imagine that the congressman coming from that district is going to be necessarily, I mean, it would be great, but I don't think they're necessarily going to be in line with my politics on everything. But I know, mm-hmm. I know John Faso is not in line with my politics on anything. But
right.
I have no way of strategically voting here. I mean, this is the sort of the same dilemma, right? Like, when I look at these candidates, the guy the funny thing is that the guy with the $9,000 Rolex, and who hasn't been accidentally photographed with their $9,000 Rolex? His rhetoric is better than Pat Ryan and Antonio Delgado's, who are the other sort of like big moneyed folks.
Right.
Gareth Rhodes.
He's very charming in person too. Flynn, he can be a very captivating candidate in person.
And he seems to talk. He doesn't soft pedal the way he talks about this stuff, which I think in this era is also good. But I'm more inclined to the politics of a Jeff Beals or a Dave Clegg. And, you know, I'm somewhat interested in a guy like Gareth Rhodes just because, his Cuomo work aside, he wasn't a longtime guy. And he's from one of those, it's sort of a Mennonite community. And they...
The Bruderhof.
Yeah. And they have... They have a real network in those counties. Mm-hmm. So if I'm looking for the one who's going to win, there's no way for me to really assess this, is there? I mean, aside from my perception of what the district would vote for and who fits that. I mean, there's no data. And the idea of someone raising money, like even for someone like myself, who's predisposed to vote against someone like that, still impacts my decision. I mean, that's sort of the tricky part of this dilemma, isn't it?
Sure. You could make an argument that almost anyone in the race is ahead right now based on different data points. A lot of people seem to think that Delgado is winning just because he's raised the most money. He has an overwhelming media presence in the area. There's just lots of mailers and commercials. Same thing with Ryan. Ryan has raised a ton of money, and it's pretty hard to live in the district and not have seen signs for Ryan. And he's got a lot of saturation. Flynn, he just gave some excellent reasons why he might be appealing to some voters. Beals hasn't raised very much money at all, but he's got the endorsement of all these Sanders organizations, and Sanders clobbered Hillary in the primary here in 2016. So you would have to think that that's that might be a factor here, right? I mean, if there's a Sanders network at all in the area, it could go to, it could easily go to Beals. I mean, Bernie got 20 or something like 32,000 votes in the district, and probably 7,000 or 8,000 votes is going to win this primary.
Right.
So you could make an argument there. You could make an argument for Clegg because he has the extensive local ties. And Rhodes, as you said, he was born in the community anyway, even if he hasn't voted there. And he, you know, if you get, you know, a few towns like Kingston to turn out and put up better than average numbers for you, you're going to win this race. I mean, it's 1 or 2% of the population is going to win this race, which is crazy.
And there's no way to assess who is going to match up against the Republican in this district, right? I mean, that's the thing that seems to be missing, and that's what you would want out of maybe not a national organization is up to the task. Maybe it needs to be, you know, these organizations need to be disaggregated, or because you could rely on the local Democratic Party. But the problem is with the local Democratic Party is that they're just as susceptible to some form of I don't want to say corruption, that's too strong of a word, but to sort of like some type of quasi nepotism or favoritism just based upon, you know, this is my buddy or, you
right.
know, you know, I mean, this is a big dilemma, it seems to me, that I'm not quite sure how it's resolved.
Yeah, no, I completely agree with you. I don't know how they figure it out. There's no easy way to resolve what the issues are. The one thing that I do see that seems to me to be an absolute concrete problem is that the National Party has an almost irrational attachment to this money-based strategy that they've been clinging to for decades now, and they just don't really know any other way of doing business, and it predisposes them to discount lots of candidates who just don't fit their profile, that doesn't fit their vision of how what kind of candidates they're looking for. And they do seem to like these candidates who come in and can raise a whole lot of money. But again, the problem with that is that you end up with a whole party full of people who have lots of backers either on Wall Street or in the defense contracting community or agribusiness or whatever it is. And that ends up creating resentment against the party across the board. And distrust, and makes it harder to win in the general. So they just have to come up with some kind of system that's more locally focused, that allows a broader range of different types of politics into the race, and doesn't measure everybody by that one measuring stick.
It seems to me, too, there could also be some type of like legitimate safe harbor period, right? Where it's like, we will not involve ourselves, I mean, legitimately not involve ourselves in the primary, like legitimately not involve the, you know, because and allow the sort of the district to make its own choice. That seems to me to be even the even bigger problem, because it's not clear to me that this district wouldn't elect someone who has like defense contractor relationships. I just don't know. But what is clear is that the National Party can't make this assessment, and they influence the outcome more than they should based upon their ability to assess who can actually win in the general. And that's like the first order problem. You know, ideology aside, it's like you're losing. Your recipe
right.
is losing. All it's doing is inserting yourself into a process so that you can legitimize your existence, but you're losing, and that's the worst case scenario.
Yeah, no, that's exactly what the problem is that they're a lot of what their calculations are based on is who they think is going to win, but those calculations are faulty. They're preparing opposition memos against people like Laura Moser in Texas. They're pushing out progressive candidates in different districts around the country. But a lot of those judgments are based on the idea that, well, we need a more conservative or a more centrist candidate for the general election. But those ideas are based on political realities that are a generation old.
Right.
And some of these districts, you're right, some of them may actually embrace somebody who works in the defense industry or is a gun person, and some of them actually might be way farther in the other direction because there's a lot of ex-union workers, because there's small family farmers. I mean there's a ton of resentment in this particular district towards corporate agribusiness because what's going on in the 19th is that the milk prices have gone through the floor because of companies like Cargill and ADM are building these sort of gigantic factory style dairy farms in other parts of the country, and it's ruining their livelihoods. So you just never know what the winning formula is, and but they're clinging to this sort of one size fits all idea about how the general election candidate needs to be more of a quote unquote centrist. And it's just too vague a description, it seems to me.
Right. And the proof is in the pudding, frankly. But all right, look, let's shift gears for a moment, because I know you wrote about this, and this is big news if people aren't aware. Steve Schmidt has left the Republican Party. So this changes everything, as you can imagine. The reverberations are really knocking around the world. Steve Schmidt, of course, was the chief campaign advisor to John McCain. And I'm being facetious. I hope people can understand that I don't.
Your sarcasm emoji is kind of shining through.
Exactly.
Right?
I mean, look, I think it speaks well of anybody who leaves the Republican Party at this point, as a bare minimum, but I don't think it changes anything. But it was an interesting segue, or an easy segue, for me to talk about your review of For Whom the Bell Tolls, the documentary about John McCain. John McCain,
yeah,
you know,
they made me review this thing.
Well, I mean, John McCain appears to be terminally ill, and they're, you know, and I think it is really important for our politics, particularly now, but always, to make an accurate assessment of someone's impact and experience in politics, particularly national figures. And there's, you know, the relationship that the media and our body politic has to John McCain is not unlike a reoccurring problem that we have even in the context of what we're seeing with these immigrant children. You know, like, Donald Trump is put over here and the Republican establishment is put over here, as if there needs to be some type of spectrum. And the fact of the matter is that the Republican, you know, the two people who are actually allowing this to happen are Mitch McConnell and Paul Ryan. Period. End of story.
Mm-hmm.
If these guys decided tomorrow to do something different, it would be over for Donald Trump. They are the fulcrum. Donald Trump is a lunatic. You can't control this guy. They are the ones who are supposed to be curtailing this. And the fact that they don't get accountability or responsibility for it seems to me to be indicative of, like, of John McCain embodies all of that at once. Like, John McCain is as responsible for Donald Trump as far as I'm concerned, anybody, because of his vice presidential pick.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, I covered that campaign and I had to spend a lot of time on the trail with John McCain. And that crucial period of time in the late summer of 2008, when the McCain campaign was beginning to get the sense that something was going badly wrong and that they had to do something to inject a little bit of energy into their race, that was a crucial moment in American history, because the Republican Party at that point could have just said, look, we're up against a uniquely gifted marketing phenomenon in Barack Obama. Whatever you want to think about Obama, he was an outstanding politician. He was going to be very, very difficult for McCain to beat that year. And I think his campaign knew that. I mean, I know they knew that because I talked to his staffers that year. And they decided to essentially, and they use this term a lot behind closed doors, to throw a Hail Mary and bring in Sarah Palin and try to keep these sort of two diverse factions of the Republican Party under one tent. Well, they're actually not that divergent, but you had this sort of crazy nascent nativist movement that was building within the Republicans, and that was very alien to McCain's own personal sensibility, that he's not comfortable around people like that. He doesn't really speak their language all that well. But he made a conscious and extremely cynical decision to bring that into his campaign and give it center stage and give it a spotlight. And it took off from there. And this crazy, uneducated, conspiratorial version of Republican politics spawned and turned into Donald Trump pretty shortly after that. I mean, you could trace it directly back to McCain.
By 2012, Mitt Romney had to go and literally kiss Donald Trump's ring at that point, right? I mean,
So, I mean, the birther thing was already out of the bag by that point. I mean, so it was already, you know, it was a short hop from Sarah Palin to the Trump movement, and I think McCain knows it too. I mean, I think Schmidt knows it, and that was one of the reasons why there was such a heavy emphasis on, you know, through movies like Game Change or, you know, on this idea that, yeah, we made a mistake, but we did the noble thing during the election in repudiating Sarah to a degree and falling on our sword and not going, you know, going over to the dark side. But that's revisionist history. They brought this out in the open. They knew exactly what they were doing. And it led to this.
And he, you know, I think like the lack of accountability, I mean, surely other members of the political press understand that, right? Like, I mean, to have injected this type of energy into that wing of the party to basically give it this like human growth hormones, right? Where you give someone mm-hmm. who is completely unqualified to serve as the vice president, never mind, you know, possibly the president, to give that to that wing of the party was insane. I mean, literally like giving, you know, human growth hormones to your, you know, your 14-year-old and saying like, well, I just, you know, I made a mistake. Shouldn't have put him in that race. You know, like it's just... And the idea that no one in the mainstream political press seems to credit John McCain with that decision, which was arguably the most important decision of his political career.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. And everybody knew what he was doing. I was at that speech that Sarah Palin gave at the Xcel Energy Center and whatever they call it in Minneapolis and or St. Paul. I forget what it is. And you know that speech was an incredible thing to be part of, because the energy in there was incredibly malevolent. But it was clear what it was all about. I mean, when she gets up there and she starts giving those lines about how small town Americans are the hardest working people in the country, and you know, everybody, it was a dog whistle filled speech that was clearly targeted at a certain attitude that is at the base of what the Trump movement is all about. And some reporters, to their credit, recognized it at the time. They could tell that McCain was taking this wild gamble, and that he was banking on bringing in this kind of energy that he personally had never had any success courting as a Republican politician. But they never really held them to account for it. You know, they always treated Palin as a separate phenomenon and not one that had been consciously brought in. And the crazy part about it is, you know, the whole legend of McCain as a straight talker, that came from the fact that he, when he was done campaigning for the day, he would often come onto the bus and he would sit down and swear like a sea captain about all these other politicians. And very frequently the people he was meanest about were the dumbest, most right-wing Republican politicians. That was one of the reasons the media loved him, is because they saw that McCain saw through the dumbest faction of his own party. And so the press couldn't have been under any illusions that McCain didn't know exactly what he was doing.
Right. Well, I can only imagine the pageantry that he will be greeted with, in his passing. And I just think it's a huge disservice that the political press does with this stuff. But I don't think that you disagree with that either.
I have to say, and I said this in the piece that I wrote, I always had this weird fondness for John McCain, because as a human being, like, he just seemed like this character that you see a lot in America, who's just this ornery, I hate everybody, kind of a jackass person who complains in restaurants and you know, makes a nuisance of himself. I know I'm not making him sound terribly sympathetic, but I have a weird kind of attraction to figures like that. But his political decision making has always been so terrible, and you know, from his reflexive backing of the worst aspects of the war on terror, right away, right? You know, and to this decision to bring Sarah Palin on, it just makes him this incredibly tragic figure who, in pursuit of, I guess, trying to be president, trying to fulfill some kind of expectations, he did all these things that were unconscionable, and you know, I think history is going to look very unkindly on that.
I hope so, but I think it's even more important that that the current climate sort of, like, you know, can sort of make these determinations, because the press falls prey to this stuff over and over again, it just seems to me. And, you know, I mean, I remember, like, John McCain was like John Stewart's favorite Republican at the time, and, you know, back in the early aughts. People somehow also forgot that, you know, he was lauded for McCain-Feingold. But people forget the reason why he did that was because he was the only person who was not indicted in the Keating 5 or 7 or whatever it was, because the guy was dirty. He was dirty.
Right.
And but Matt Taibbi, always a pleasure, buddy. I guess we're not going to fix it today. All right. I appreciate it. We'll talk
to
you soon.
All right, take care, man.
Bye-bye. We're going to put a link up to Taibbi's pieces, both of the review of, I've already forgotten what the name of the John McCain.
Battle of Woodstock.
No, the John McCain, For Whom the Bell Tolls. Yeah, well, you know, it's not a very famous title. And I'd never heard of it. And we'll put up a link to the Battle for Woodstock. A couple of things. I am seeing some indication that Donald Trump is caving on this. Is that the case? Is that supposedly Donald Trump is going to sign something shortly? We're very strong. Okay, here we go. So let's listen to this. This is Donald Trump caving. Now, what's been fascinating about this is that you see all these reports of, like, Stephen Miller. This is exactly what we wanted. And this, all this revisionist history about, you know, Steve Bannon was also saying, like, this is what we wanted when we had the Muslim ban. We wanted all these snowflakes to come out to the airport. I got news for you. BS. And anybody who buys that is, I would love, there's a lot of different products I would love to sell them, starting with some repackaged beta male vitality serum. Because, first of all, they could have never known the size of the response to the Muslim ban. No one would have predicted that. And secondly, I don't think they would have predicted this either. It has been a disastrous, and this is second, third order analysis. Even for a White House, which I am convinced is at best ambivalent about the idea of the Democrats taking the House. Because, I mean, let's face it, Donald Trump has no legislative agenda. Anything that the Republicans really want to pass at this point, right? They would have loved to have cut Social Security and Medicare, but at the end of the day, it's just so that they can afford tax cuts. They've already gotten those tax cuts. And they want to pack the judiciary. You don't need the House to do that. You can do that all by maintaining the Senate. And I think Donald Trump was going out there campaigning on the obstruction of Democrats that much better if you actually do have the Democrats obstruct him, because then you don't actually have to do anything. And this is not a guy who came into the White House with a big legislative agenda. So I think there's a certain amount of ambivalence. It's quite possible that they don't care that much about retaining the House. I don't know. But the pressure has been so great on Republican lawmakers. And like I've said, Mitch McConnell and Paul Ryan have the ability to shut down all of it. Not just this, all of it at any time. They have had this ability since October of 2016. They could have shut down all of it. They could have shut down Donald Trump, and they didn't want to because of their base. They don't have any political, courage. There's the last honest, whatever marketing they promote. It's all simply a lie. But the pressure became so great that they went over to the White House and said, "Look, you've got to change your mind." Their politics is working here. It's just that the Republican Party is far more morally decrepit than they get credit for. That's what's going on. We're witnessing politics working. It's just that their moral decrepitness is so much beyond what our mainstream understanding is of this party that people think politics aren't working. People think that Donald Trump is not subject to the laws of political physics. He is. It's just that people don't understand how horrible the Republican Party is. But here is Donald Trump indicating that he's going to be signing something in a few minutes to keep families together.
We are very strong at the border. We're very strong on security. We want security for our country and insist on security for our country. And we will have that. At the same time, we have compassion. We want to keep families together. It's very important. I'll be signing something in a little while that's going to do that. And the people in this room want to do that. And they're working on various pieces of legislation to get it done. But I'll be doing something that's somewhat preemptive, but ultimately will be matched by legislation, I'm sure.
That's just gibberish. In other words, what he's saying is that we didn't have to do any of this in the first place. We're going to revert back to it. And then maybe I'll get some political cover for it later. But good. Anything that stops this horrific practice is good. But frankly, I still would advocate people continuing protests against all these people.
Don't stop. And now all that will happen too. And of course, it is politics working. It's a significant improvement. But a bunch of families now being in privately run prison detention centers on the border is not the pinnacle of politics or justice either. And even if the policy was completely reversed across the board, which obviously it isn't, these people should never feel comfortable or respected in any public forum ever for any part of their careers or natural lives, period.
Right. You don't get credit for reversing a policy because you think it's politically damaging to you. Right. Not my estimation. Not one that is this morally.
Also really like the emphasis on, like, enough with people giving this sort of, like, oh, Bannon knew this was going to happen. Like, stop overthinking it. Stop giving them credit to their reporting.
That's the reporting that we're getting, and it's spin, obviously, silly. All right, we're going to take a quick break, head into the fun half. Just a reminder, folks, it's your support that makes this show possible. You can become a member by going to jointhemajorityreport.com. At jointhemajorityreport.com, you will be able to join the Majority Report. And as a way of saying thank you, we give you extra content. Some people say, well, I don't want to join. I just want to do a one-off donation. Well, if you go to jointhemajorityreport.com, at the top of that page, you'll have the opportunity to do a one-off donation. So either way, your support is appreciated. If you want the extra time, the extra content, but you are experiencing any type of financial hardship, whether temporary or you're on a fixed income and you simply can't afford it, but you would enjoy the extra content, send us an email. Have a little bit of patience at majorityreporters@gmail.com, and we will hook you up. Also, today is Wednesday. That means yesterday was Tuesday. That means yesterday night was Tuesday night. That means the Michael Brooks show happened. And if memory serves me correctly, Bhaskar Sankara was on.
That's correct.
And EQ was on.
Will EQ. I like that.
Will I call EQ.
EQ. EQ. That dynamic, EQ. Independent rapper.
I call him EQ. Will EQ. He likes both. It doesn't matter. And nice. And he was on the program last night.
And in the post game, I will say this, which is obviously for patrons. We did the dramatic read of Bill Clinton's new thriller with James Patterson, and also developed some future series ideas for the president going missing and evolving ideas of personal space in the global economy.
I'm not even sure how to...
Did you hear...
They found about him was his bathrobe.
Where the president went missing again. Wonder where he is.
So you can check that out via Patreon or iTunes or YouTube or all three. Doesn't hurt. And of course, speaking of Patreon, Jamie's program that she co-hosts, The Antifada, is available at patreon.com/TheAntifada. New episode dropping
today.
There you go.
Part one.
Fresh. Super fresh.
Hell yeah.
And still warm, but not quite as fresh. Just from Saturday. So it's still pretty warm.
Yeah, but like pizza, even when it's cold, it's still really good. Rip Van Winkle episode 2 was released this weekend. It's on Stitcher, Google Play, iTunes, all the places you want to look, and patreon.com/literaryhangover.
You did. I mean, that also, you came up with that pizza thing, but you didn't even say the name of the podcast.
Literary Hangover.
Okay.
Also, Matt's Matt is like durable. It's a durable podcast. It's about literature and history. It's not on the same time compression.
Right. Evergreen.
Time is not delaying for that. All right, we got to take a quick break. 646-257-3920. Don't forget, justcoffee.coop, fair trade coffee, tea, or chocolate. Use the coupon code MAJORITY, get 10% off. See you in a moment. Say, Juniper.